Well, welcome to this session. It's my pleasure to welcome you all to this occasion that it's multiply special session because it's multiply sponsored. And that means before I begin, I have many people to thank. My name is Tomoko Masuzawa. I am actually a duly member of both AAR and SBL, I'm happy to say. And this special session was really made through it became possible through the efforts of a number of people. And as you see, even though it originated in the cultural history of the study of religion group of the AAR, it is also co-sponsored by the Bible and Cultural Studies group of the SBL, as well as the North American Association for the Study of Religion. On behalf of us all who wanted to see this happen, I should like to thank the program director of the AAR, as well as SBL, as well as Robert Yell and Winnie Sullivan in particular of the NASA, among the NASA officers who made this all possible. Of course, I should thank all of those on the panel who have not only endured, I would say, that who have been really ever so graciously participating in the email exchange and exchange of notes and ideas in preparation for this occasion. And last but not least, in fact, most importantly, I'd like to thank Ward Blanton of the University of Glasgow, who in fact did much of this organizing of this panel. However, he is on the audience instead because of the, you know, the AAR SBL rule of the overexposure. He is ever so resourceful and being in demand. He's on so many other programs, so that I am in fact standing up here, otherwise he would be here. So let me just briefly explain before we start how this came about, and as it's been in preparation for some time. Many of you no doubt recall the considerable commotion several years back when the AAR leadership at the time announced its decision to hold its annual meeting separately from the SBL, thus departing from the established practice of much of our living memory, you might say. Now, wisdom or not of the decision or the ensuing controversies aside, the incident gave many of us, including myself, of course, an occasion to think about the relation, not only between the two organizations, but more broadly and consequentially, I think, between the two adjacent scholarly domains that we inhabit, the two domains that could be adequately circumscribed by the terms biblical studies and religious studies. Now, relation may be described various ways, nervous overlapping, dissonant conjoining, or perhaps dyspeptically incorporated. In any event, the borderline between the two appears to be rather fuzzy and neuralgic as well. And I think there is actually a kind of a tertiary ghost in between, and that's probably theology. So if we are to be a kind of a Trinitarian terms, I think the Holy Ghost is the theology, but that's another matter. Nervous or not, for those many of us who belong to a religion department, as I did myself some years back, the cohabitation of biblical studies and religious studies is very much a matter of living reality and as a matter of necessity, right? And as with most domestic arrangements, the nature of this long-standing relation is pretty opaque to outsiders, I think. And our neighbors, academic neighbors, don't really get the point of our latest disturbance. Tried to explain this to my colleagues in history department. You don't really get the much sympathetic or understanding view of this thing. Anyway. It occurs to me that I'm sure it did not, as it did to many others, that it is high time we re-examine this relation between the two domains, both as living reality and possibly a convolution rooted in the past history. Now, did I have a vested interest in this matter? Of course. And in fact, I might say that given my current interest. I may have even a reason to take it personally, but that's another matter. So it's my task to introduce our six speakers this afternoon. And I would like to, in fact, introduce each speaker as he or she speaks, because otherwise running into all six of together might be a little bit long speech. So let me first introduce, before I start, I have, everybody is supposed to speak up to 15 minutes, and we will have a conversation, including you and the audience, of course, after all six speakers has spoken. So the first speaker is Yvonne Sherwood, who is a professor of Bible, religion, and culture at the University of Glasgow in the Department of Theology and Religious Studies. Well, this title already says a lot of our situation, I think. And she holds a bachelor's degree in English literature and PhD in biblical studies, both from the University of Sheffield, and also a graduate diploma in Jewish studies from Oxford University. Now, so given that, no surprise that she's active in both AAR and SBL, as many of us are, in fact, in this panel. Liz, did you rejoin the AAR as well, or are you still thinking about it? Okay. But anyway, so I shouldn't have put her on the spot. Yvonne is active in both organizations very much, and if we follow her work, I think we will be treated to a truly multivalent view on the biblical studies and on religious studies from the perspective of literary theory, philosophy, Jewish studies, and feminist criticism, among other most obvious ones. Her most recent book are entitled The Invention of the Biblical Scholar, which just came out, and the other one due next year is Biblical Blaspheming, Trials of the Sacred for Secular Age, due next year. So, very productive scholar. Yvonne, please.
Thank you. This is a huge room. It's vaguely reminiscent of the 2002 Derrida and Religion event, which felt like being at some kind of revival meeting. In the short time I've got, I'm going to have a go at scrambling the perceived relationships between the Bible and religion on two fronts, conceptually, and then in terms of disciplinary genealogies. What's the purpose of bringing the dusty old Bible scholar back into the arena of religion? Is her task to serve as a red-faced exemplar of a parochially Protestant Christian understanding of religion? A dark reminder, perhaps, of past sins of scripturalism. Not so long ago, the alternative to the SBL was not the AAR, but its forerunner, the National Association of Bible Instructors, with the acronym NABI, Hebrew for prophet. Under the dominion of Bible, religion was folded back into the book, as, according to the mission statement, the beliefs, morals, and practices encoded in scripture. Now it seems that we're witnessing an ironic return of that old scriptural motif of the late-born displacing the firstborn. For the AAR now has the upper hand, so much so that it could attempt to shed its fusty old brother in a fraternal schism that has now been healed. And we have patched it up, haven't we? I'm not sure quite how to read the present situation, whether it's cohabitation or rent sharing. But I like Tomoko's dyspeptically incorporated. The reversal of power relations has to do with the different but related roles played by the concept of Bible, the concepts Bible and religion in modernity. Imagined as the more expansive, ironic, and tolerant term, religion has a skill set far more suited to the self-consciously modern polity. Unlike Bible, it has a distinct advantage of being able to take an S and making a virtue of that ability to take an S. The Bible, in contrast, serves as a sign for that which birthed modernity. precisely at the point when we fell over the Bible's edge. Whether we date it from the discovery of the Americas, revealing a whole new continent that the allegedly omniscient Bible and its Nabis had not counted on, or John Locke's quip that Genesis was not a document that carried much weight with the Chinese, or freethinkers like Cyrano de Bergerac wondering how biblical authors could ever have thought that, quote, the earth was flat as an oven and swam on water like one half of a sliced orange, or myriad other starting points. The result is that the Bible, as the emblem and mascot of Christendom, retreats into the space of the old time, the time of our believing, our naivete, our past. The parochialization of the Bible is so intrinsic to the production of the modern that it would be hard to even find our way to the modern, to find that unique path to modernity, without using signposts and milestones like Locke displacing Habakkuk, to cite a particularly nice example from Marx. And the choice of that most foreign-sounding word, Habakkuk, perfectly illustrates the role of the Bible as an exotic theme park, past land. By accepting that their task is essentially, if not exclusively, historical, biblical scholars have perpetuated this sense that the Bible is not just in the past, it is somehow the past per se. But then religion is also an awkward remainder or self-constituting allergy term for modernities. As Ninian Smart put it back in the 1980s, having been dethroned as the queen of sciences, the study of religion has now become the knave of arts. Following a recent restructuring at the University of Glasgow, we found ourselves in a curiously named School of Critical Studies. One alternative proposal, the School of Literature, Language and Religion, was rejected because many colleagues felt deeply squeamish about being associated with religion, with its dubious flirtations with the numinous and the dubious, and things that go bump in the night. This looks like a parable of the place of religion in modernity, albeit one written unconsciously. In modernity, religion is masked or subsumed under the distinctly modern practice of critique, as in our School of Critical Studies. Religion can be included in, insofar as it bends over backwards to translate itself out of itself into other terms entirely, insofar as it affirms constantly that it is not simply religious. The perceived softness of the word religion is a potential liability to arts and humanities faculties striving to demonstrate in an ever tighter battle for resources with the hard scientists that they are sufficiently robust. Religion does not have the same exchange value as a word like literature or history. It's possible to do a literary reading of the text of religion or a historical reading of the archive of religion. But a religious reading of history or literature would suggest something weaker and dubiously partisan belonging, say, in a seminary or a church. So as the soft and flimsy arts are to the hard sciences, so religion is to the arts, and the Bible is to religion, as, so to speak, the doubly displaced knave of the knave of arts. As a disputed and ephemeral object, with a rather shaky standing in the university, religion achieves maximal existence through acts of differentiation from theology and biblical studies, as hangovers from Christendom. Religion becomes most plausible as an object of study when it's defined as an anthropological, not a theological category, or when it tells parables of the relationship between Bible and religion, where the biblical scholar usually ends up with egg on her face. I'm thinking particularly of the essays The Study of Religion and The Study of the Bible from 1971 by Cantwell Smith and The Bible and Religion of 1999 by J.Z. Smith. The two Smiths, so to speak, conjure the limits of biblical scholarship in equal and opposite terms. Cantwell Smith portrays it as robotic historicism or depersonalized science, and J.Z. Smith as a place of excessive disciplinary piety without critical distance, then projecting religion as the other of the limits of the biblical scholar. This suggests that the two fields, Bible and religion, are shot through with the same paradoxes and tensions, which relate to the awkward placing and displacing of the religious in the modern West. Religious studies is a conflicted space where religion appears as sui generis, utterly distinct, but also where it must also be zealously hunted out of its privileged hiding place and translated into other terms entirely. Biblical studies combines a strange reification of the Bible as a special object of disciplinary devotion with the work of Bibelwissenschaft, acts of translation and mediation designed to translate Bible into more robust domains of language, history, archaeology, botany, numismatics, linguistics, economics, the list is endless. Bibelwissenschaft has functioned as an institutional machine for producing effects of secularization by translating the Bible out of specifically religious languages into solid human disciplines available for all. And all this effort is for a strange, secular, modern everyman who nevertheless seeks to devote himself to the minutiae of this very particular text. Both fields regularly erupt into laments that the modern discourse of religion and Bible is alienated from its true object. Ornithology is not flying, religious studies is a pale shadow of religion, only the confessors can properly understand the Bible. Both equally regularly issue clarion calls to return more zealously to the true work of demystification. Both suffer from what Richard King terms iatrogenesis, or what Derrida terms autoimmunity, in that the cure for the problems of religion in modernity effectively destroy the object. What most demands our attention, I think, is precisely this paradox of self-elimination and self-reification. The reverence for Bible and religion as exceptional terms, combined with the move to explain Bible and religion as nothing but an alibi or projection of something else. Because we think of religion as a secular or anthropological other to theology and Bible, we tend to look for pure genealogies coming from independent spaces, uncontaminated by Bibles and the monotone, monotheistic polemic that Bibles are imagined to contain. Quests for origins or pre-origins of religious studies seem to stick rigidly, even religiously, to first occurrences of the truly independent term religio, not, heaven help us, bad old polemical words like idolatry, superstition, or desidemonia. Prehistories of the discipline pass in general through the Greco-Latin classics and proto-secular dynastic lines such as Euhemerus, Varro, Cusa, Hobbes, Vico, and Hume. Of course, innovations in biblical scholarship are acknowledged as crossing over with the study of religion. Robertson Smith names John Spencer's late 17th century analysis of the laws and rites of the Hebrews as an early precursor of comparative religion. And not least through Susan Martin's fabulous work on German Orientalism, we're familiar with the work of German biblical scholars and Orientalists like J.D. Michaelis, who were busy comparing Mosaic law and Bedouin customs and arranging expeditions to Arabia in order partly to find out the Arabic name for the ox-like creature in Job 39, the true botanical source of the Balm of Gilead, and the tides at the outmost reaches of the Red Sea. But often the point of overlap between Bible and nascent religious studies is found at the point where new sciences and questions are imposed on the Bible from a place outside Bible. So, for example, by applying Maimonides' theory of accommodation, John Spencer is creating new proto-secular possibilities for reading Hebrew rites as effects of foreign influence or a survival of ancient ceremonies. But this innovation, in a sense, was not patented by Spencer or even Maimonides. It's in the Bible. When the biblical writers want to expel or relativize rites or traditions that now seem surplus to requirements past their use-by dates, they argue that these rites came from mingling with other nations or from an old, old moribund time, radically discontinuous with ours, so they displace them both in time and in space. The notion of mingling sets up uncanny resonances between home and foreign religion, also implied in idolatry, Latin simulacrum. Idolatry is not just the other then to the more expansive and tolerant category of religion. It's not simply a ruse for eliminating the other by polemic or genocide or both. Idolatry exhibits an astonishing fluidity on the stage of a Bible which is strangely crowded, swarming with other peoples and their gods, a place where monotheism is not always even devoutly wished consistently, let alone achieved. A reflection on idols in the first century text, The Wisdom of Solomon, combines the solid thump of polemic, idols are nothing, vain illusions, they are evil, with various hypotheses of idolatry sources in something a little bit like psychology or sociology or politics or statecraft or aesthetics. They originate with our desire for beauty, from our grief and mourning, from realpolitik, and the desire to clone and disseminate the presence of the king. It seems to me that this passage, which is not simply euhemeristic, translating the religious into all too human sources, but also empathetic, anticipates closely what we seem to mean when we talk about the ideation of religion, a category that seems to depend on getting the spacing just right. We need a certain critical distance and a sense of strangeness, but this needs to be delicately balanced with a certain proximity and empathy, so the alien religion must not be so far away that it becomes nothing, but also not so close that it's absorbed into ourselves. Taken up by figures like Lactantius and Aquinas, this text from Wisdom became one of the main keys for interpreting the religions of the Aztecs, the Maya, and the Incas, contributing to the strangely proto-ethnographic interpretations of the religion of the other at the colonial frontier. José da Costa's Natural and Moral History of the Indies, which was widely disseminated in Europe and read by people like Hobbes and Locke, but which has now largely dropped off the radar when we write stories of the emergence of the modern and the modern category of religion, used the template from the Wisdom of Solomon to create a taxonomy of idolatry, now morphing into something closer to what we would mean by religion. Even more striking is the reading of alien religion by the 16th century Dominican Bartolomé de las Casas. Here, latreia, worship, and idolatreia are not antitheses, but analogous and comparable categories. The Wisdom of Solomon merges with models from Valla and Aristotle to make latreia and idolatreia equally complex edifices of human construction and techne or technique. The Aristotelian model of fantasia is applied to idolatry, eidolon, phantasm, to show how idolatry results from a fragile and erratic mind machine, which can be profoundly affected by factors such as emotional imbalance, natural environment, habit and customs, biology, as well as demons and original sin. As in the syncopated template in Wisdom, the sources of idolatry seem to merge the pre-modern and the modern, the environmental, psychological, and demonic. Most poignantly, the fragile ecosystem of the mind is portrayed as having been disrupted by the trauma of the Spanish invasion, so that in a strangely proleptically modern move, our sense of their faulty projection of religion is related in quite a powerful way to our prejudice and our guilt. Thank you.
Thank you, Yvonne. The second speaker is Professor Liz Clark, who is a John Carlo Kilgo Professor of Religion and Professor of History at Duke University, where she has been on the faculty since 1982. Her latest book, Founding the Fathers, Early Church History and Protestant Professors in 19th Century America, just published this year. And also among her more recent among her dozens or so books are Reading Renunciation, Asceticism, and Scripture in Early Christianity, and History, Theory, Text, Historians, and the Linguistic Turn, And so again, those book titles really says much about the breadth of scholarship. Liz, please. Incidentally, I did not ask any all the presenters to give any titles, so I have no titles to give them.
Somewhere so I don't drop it on your computer here.
There we go. Sure.
Scratchy throat. As Tomoko just announced earlier this year, my book on Protestant professors and early church history in 19th century America was published, which detailed the teaching of that subject in four important 19th century seminaries, Princeton, Harvard, Yale, and Union. One argument of the book, which I here elaborate, was that the study of post-New Testament early Christianity, or late ancient Christianity as we sometimes call it now, could not develop in a religious studies direction until scholars in the field relinquished the view that the books of the New Testament occupied a completely different category than post-biblical Christian texts. The scholars at these seminaries in the 19th century wished to cordon off the unique testimonies of Jesus and the apostles from all later Christian materials. Dispensing with the boundary between the New Testament and post-New Testament texts was one aspect of more radical German scholarship, especially that of the Tübingen school, that so disturbed these American professors. For the latter, the New Testament remained a static and unchanging, undeveloping text against which a developing patristic and later Christianity was charted. Without doubt, German criticism set much of the teaching and research agenda for these American professors, yet their reactions to it remained largely negative. Not until this conservative approach to the Bible was abandoned could views of historical development, also imbibed from Germany, be allowed to stretch back to the earliest days of the Jesus movement. Only then did professors abandon the supernaturalistic approach that precluded studying the Bible as an ancient text like others. Mark Knoll, his Surveying Biblical Scholarship in 19th Century America, calls the early Protestant seminaries centers of advanced study designed to defang criticism and to absorb the new facts into orthodoxy. Although Knoll's claim may overstate the motivation for the founding of these seminaries, it perceptively describes how most of the 19th century professors I studied had operated. That the Gospels were not composed by eyewitnesses to Jesus' life, that Paul did not write the pastoral epistles, that the New Testament was to be treated in academia, not as a divine, incomparable revelation, but as a source for the history of the first and second centuries, these propositions were strongly rejected by professors in America. The New Testament, they averred, should not be subjected to the same critical scrutiny as other ancient texts, such as those of the patristic era. Only at century's end would more critical treatments receive a friendlier reception. It is often assumed that scientific discoveries were the factor most disturbing to 19th century Christians' faith in the inerrancy of biblical accounts. Indeed, new understandings of geology, the age of the earth, followed by paleontological and biological discoveries, shook the framework in which Christian scholars had understood ancient history. But it is startling to grasp the extent to which modern, supposedly liberal professors of Christianity's history struggled to keep Adam and Eve in their Edenic landscape, indeed as primitive monotheists, well into the age of Darwin. I would argue that even these scientific novelties did not outweigh more overarching changes in the approach to the Bible's unique status. Today, in the interest of time, I'll focus on one such professor, Philip Schaff. Schaff, upon his arrival from Europe in 1844, taught first at Mercersburg Theological Seminary, and then from 1870 until his death in 1893 at Union Theological Seminary in New York. Schaff is an especially good subject on whom to focus. Not only was he America's most renowned 19th century professor of church history, he was in some ways an enlightened liberal in his relatively sympathetic assessment of the patristic and medieval periods, his cordial friendship with Roman Catholics, and his pointed critique of sectarian Protestantism in America. Schaff had studied in Germany and worked in Germany from 1837 to 1844. Despite his German education and constant contact with scholars in Europe, his approach to the New Testament was decidedly conservative. A decisive, impassable line existed between the books of the canonical New Testament and all other Christian texts. Schaff served as president of the American Committee on the Revision of the King James Version of the Bible in the 1870s and 1880s, but it was not an area of text criticism in which his biblical conservatism emerges. Rather, it was the higher criticism that gave him trouble. His categories for understanding early Christian literature numbered only two: genuine and fraudulent. Genuine meant that the books were written by those whose names stand on them. For the Gospels, the immediate disciples of Jesus. To posit that the Gospels were composed later by non-apostolic authors would be, Schaff said, to dismiss them as frauds, a willful deceit perpetrated on believers. For Schaff, patristic writers' citation of New Testament passages proved the genuineness and integrity of the apostolic writings and the content of the books as trustworthy. Schaff appealed to various factors to argue for the gospel's genuineness. One rests on the claim that Jesus and his first followers knew Greek. Hence, there is no reason to doubt the apostolic authority or authorship of the gospels and the veracity of Jesus' words therein. Jesus, Schaff claimed, spoke Greek, though not exclusively, and the apostles wrote it with naturalness and ease. If Jesus' disciples, unlettered fishermen of Galilee, knew Greek because they wrote the Gospels, why should not Jesus? Greek served the apostolic mission well, like French in our day, Schaff added. To be sure, the Greek of the New Testament was designed for the common people, but this lower style was supremely proper for a universal religion. No doubt is cast on the faith, Schaff insisted, because we lack writings by Jesus, although writing was not beneath his dignity. Did not God himself write the two tables, that is, the Ten Commandments? We do not crave a book-writing Christ, but one of sympathy and love, he concluded. Thus, Schaff sought to guarantee the genuineness of dominical and apostolic voices. The genuineness of the New Testament books might also be called into question by the relative lateness of the manuscripts on which the received text was based. Schaff conceded that the oldest manuscripts date only to the 4th century. We lack the apostles' original writings, as he called them. Schaff offered an ingenious explanation for why no originals remain. By divine arrangement, the New Testament books were first composed on papyrus, a material of short lifespan, so that the loss of the autographs of the apostles, as he called them, would stimulate inquiry and prompt a more thorough search for the spirit and the reading of the text. On this explanation, genuineness is not cast in doubt. Dating all New Testament books to the first century also helped to secure their genuineness, affording a tight link to the inspired apostolic era. Schaff held that all New Testament books, excepting the Johannine corpus, were composed before 70. He called the Gospels the inspired biographical memoirs of Jesus Christ. The evangelists, as objective historians, refrained from intruding their own views. They modestly abstained, he said, from adding their own impressions to the record of the words and acts of the Master. Yet Schaff admitted that the Orthodox theory of verbal inspiration could not account for the discrepancies in the Gospels. These he explained as deriving from the Gospel's status, not as full biographies, but as memoirs. Each evangelist selected certain features of Jesus' life and work as best suited his purpose and the class of his readers. John, for example, omits many points, such as imminent eschatology, that the other evangelists had included. But he did not need to, Schaff claimed, since these points were already familiar. The four canonical Gospels thus present a harmonious picture of Jesus' life and teachings. Schaff also affirmed the unity of the Johannine corpus and its authorship by the disciple John. John wrote the Apocalypse first, then the Epistles, and late in the century, the Gospel, which Schaff called God's love letter to man. All share, he insisted, the same theology and Christology. Were it not for John's writings, the period between 70 and 100 would be nearly blank. Some critics, Schaff protested, have assailed the citadel, that is, the disciple John's authorship of the fourth gospel. This, for Schaff, is a question of life and death between constructive and destructive criticism. No second century writer, such as Strauss and Bauer had proposed, could have produced this marvelous book, he argued. Are we to imagine that for 1800 years, deluded Christians have mistaken a Gnostic dream for the genuine history of the Savior of mankind, drinking the water of life from the muddy source of fraud? Such is unthinkable for Schaff. Given these views, it does not surprise to learn that Schaff faulted Tübingen school criticism. Bauer, in Schaff's judgment, had reduced early Christianity's rich spiritual life into conflicting tendencies of Petrinism and Paulinism, resolved in a Hegelian synthesis. Bauer and his followers, Schaff charge, ignore the supernatural element of inspiration. They lack spiritual sympathy with the faith of the apostles. They overstrain Paul's antagonism to Judaism, and they accept only four of the letters as Pauline. They sunder early Christian thought from its religious life ground, and show great want of spiritual discernment in assigning even the Gospel of John to the borrowed moonlight, as he called it, of the post-apostolic age. Radical biblical critics like Bauer could never get a chair in America, Schaff claimed, not even in the Divinity School of Harvard University, whereas they win professorships in Germany, Switzerland, and Holland. Despite Schaff's rejection of Bauer's views on the New Testament, he generously judged him as the most able modern opponent of traditional Christianity. Yet it was only a few years after Schaff's death in 1893 that his successor at Union, Arthur Cushman McGifford, as well as professors at the new University of Chicago, abandoned these older ideas. A new era in the study of early Christianity was beginning in American seminaries, and from then, it also went on to colleges and universities. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Our third speaker is Brent Nongbri. Am I pronouncing this right? Okay. He is fairly recent, fresh PhD recently from the Religious Studies Department at Yale University. He has taught previously at Oberlin College, but right now he is a postdoctoral fellow at Macquarie University in Sydney, Australia. Though, as you can see, so young as he is, his accomplishments and both accomplishments and ambition, I think, are clearly visible from the scope of publications that he has under his to his credit already, which includes a recent article entitled The Lord's Player and Kai Mu Gamma, is that right? Whatever that. It published in Harvard Theological Review. Two neglected textual variants in Philippians 1 was published in Journal of Biblical Literature, and Dislodging Embedded Religion, A Brief Note on Scholarly Trope, which was published in Newman. So you can sort of see that he also bridges quite broadly. We have also the all the more reason, therefore, to look forward to his forthcoming book, forthcoming from Yale University next year, entitled Before Religion, A History of a Modern Concept, from which I assume we'll hear a little bit about today. Thank you.
Thank you very much for that introduction. So for this panel, we were asked to analyze the mutual influence and interrelation of modern biblical studies and the academic study of religion more generally. I was asked to direct my comments to the study of Paul's letters and the category of religion. I want to start, though, with a characteristically provocative quotation from Jonathan Z. Smith. In a plenary address at the 1999 annual meeting of the SBL, actually one that Yvonne has already mentioned, Smith had the following to say. Unlike many sorts of interpretive materials available to the student of religion, the scholarly study of the Bible remains, to a remarkably large degree, an affair of native exegesis. That is to say, the sort of accounts that for other religious traditions constitute data for the study of religion. One consequence of this is that for all the hermeneutic subtlety at times displayed in wrestling with problems of historical and linguistic difference, biblical scholarship, unlike most other fields in the Western enterprise of the study of religions, has not been formed by that cluster of urgent and complex methodological and theoretical issues gathered together under the label the insider-outsider problem. Smith's observations that much biblical scholarship is native exegesis seems to me to be especially true of Pauline scholarship. And indeed, Smith goes on to point out that students of the Hebrew Bible seem more comfortable using the concept of religion to analyze their materials, while New Testament scholars, on the whole, seem allergic to the concept of religion. In fact, Smith claims that he could, at that time, think of no important study of the New Testament or early Christianities that used the term religion in its title. I find this kind of interesting, given that in 1982, Smith spent a number of pages in his classic work, Imagining Religion, critiquing just such a book, E.P. Sanders' Paul and Palestinian Judaism, which was published in 1977 and carried the subtitle, A Comparison of Patterns of Religion. Now, Smith did show, with quite devastating effect, that Sanders' use of the idea of a pattern of religion was ill-defined and confusing. Nevertheless, Sanders' study has been massively influential among biblical scholars, and it explicitly invoked the concept of religion. Sanders' book, and its position in the history of scholarship on Paul, can act as a nice focusing lens for thinking about some of the issues that draw us together today. Viewed from a certain angle, Paul and Palestinian Judaism can show some of the ways that biblical studies and religious studies are interrelated. To contextualize Sanders' work in this way, I want to briefly place it in conversation with the work of Karl Barth earlier in the 20th century. In his Church Dogmatics, Barth had declared flatly that the revelation of God, as it was announced in Paul's letters, was antithetical to religion. This theme also ran through Barth's highly popular commentary on Romans, in which religion was essentially equated with the Judaism that Barth understood Paul to be attacking. For Barth, religion was a thoroughly theological category, a human effort to find salvation, a human effort that Paul opposed with his concepts of faith, grace, and gospel. This tradition of interpretation of Paul is strong even today among historical critics. One can see it quite clearly in, for example, something like Lou Martin's commentary on Galatians in the prestigious Anchor Bible series. While Sanders' Paul and Palestinian Judaism makes no reference to Bart, Sanders' refusal to pit faith or grace against religion in general as a cipher for Judaism in particular marked a real challenge to the kind of approach represented by Bart. In Sanders' view, Paul did not find fault with Judaism because of its inherent deficiency as a religion. Rather, in Sanders' famous formulation, what Paul found wrong with Judaism was simply that it was not Christianity. Thus, while Sanders portrayed Judaism in a way more palatable to Christian scholars by maintaining that it was focused on grace, he also claimed that the religion Paul advocated was very different from Judaism. In Sanders' model, the religion of Judaism presented a valid means of salvation, but it was a means of salvation that Paul rejected in favor of Christ. Sanders described this project of his as what he called a fair comparison of the religion of Paul and the religion of Judaism. He sought to, quote, compare an entire religion, parts and all, with an entire religion, parts and all. He wanted to, quote, discover two wholes, both of which are considered and defined on their own merits and in their own terms, to be compared with one another. Sanders' solution for comparing Judaism with the religion of Paul was to study their respective patterns of religion, by which he meant the function of the religions, how one gets from what he called the logical starting point to the logical conclusion of a religion. As I mentioned, Jonathan Z. Smith subjected Sanders' formulation to a withering methodological critique. I'm going to quote Smith at some length. Allowing for the moment the language of entire and wholes to stand unquestioned, and setting aside the difficulty, indeed the impossibility of comparing two different objects, each considered and defined in their own terms, a statement which he cannot mean literally, but which he gives no indication as to how he would modify, Sanders compounds the confusion by further defining the notion of a pattern. It's not a total historical entity like Christianity, Judaism, or Islam, but only a given more or less homogeneous entity. How much more or how much less is needed to posit homogeneity, and hence a pattern, is left unclear. It is a matter of seeing how one moves from the logical starting point to the logical conclusion of the religion. But this notion of logic is nowhere clarified. Indeed, it seems thrown aside by Sanders' exclusion of what he terms speculative matters of methodology, and by his strange insistence that the logic is one of function. Given these restrictions, I am baffled by what entire religion, parts and all, could possibly mean for Sanders. I find no methodological hints on how such entities are to be discovered, let alone compared. His results give me no ground for confidence. Smith's critique is on target, but apparently he did not look very hard for Sanders' methodological hints. In fact, Sanders is quite clear that his pattern of religion is closely related to what theologians have traditionally called soteriology. He even writes, quote, a pattern of religion has largely to do with the items which a systematic theology classifies under soteriology, end quote. One can thus isolate a pattern of religion by arranging one's data to mirror the very traditional Christian notion of a system of beliefs leading individuals to salvation. In this respect, Sanders' projects seem to be basically a comparative theology. Now, within the field of biblical studies, Sanders' work met with rather different kinds of critique than what Smith has offered. From one side, reactionaries claim Sanders was simply wrong. On this view, Paul really did critique Judaism as a false religion of human works. Others, however, have argued that Sanders did not go far enough in rethinking Paul and Judaism. Here I have in mind that branch of Pauline scholarship that Magnus Zetterholm has recently labeled the Radical New Perspective on Paul. This is a group of scholars that would include Christer Stendahl, Lloyd Gaston, John Gager, Paula Fredrickson, and Pamela Eisenbaum, among others. As I read them, these authors take issue especially with Sanders' assertion that Paul found something wrong with Judaism, with the idea that Paul believed Jews must convert to Christ. According to at least some of the radicals, Paul in fact approved of two paths to salvation, nomos or Torah for Jews and Christ for non-Jews. This assertion of the validity of multiple different ways to salvation seems very much at home in the pluralistic atmosphere of the study of religion that one finds in many North American departments of religious studies and in the more liberal divinity schools. Viewed from this angle, the so-called radical new perspective does not seem very radical at all. Instead, this picture of Paul fits quite comfortably into the current academic interest in religious pluralism. Paul is affirming multiple valid paths to salvation. Or perhaps it would be better to say that this wing of the new perspective is indeed radical relative to the generally conservative field of Pauline studies, in which a kind of normative Christian orthodoxy still holds sway. But it's rather less radical in relation to what we might call the normative religious pluralist orthodoxy of religious studies departments. Now, it's hard to avoid overgeneralizing in the context of a 10-minute talk. So before closing, I want to note that there are exceptions to this general rule that I just sketched. We could look, for example, at the work of Stanley Stowers, a Pauline scholar who has in a series of recent essays articulated a clear theory of religion as a second-order category for the study of antiquity. He has begun to use the data of Paul's letters to raise questions of interest to a wider academic community in the humanities and social sciences. That is to say, Stowers is doing the sort of work that I view as religious studies and biblical studies at its best. At the end of the day, then, I agree with Jonathan Z. Smith's contention that biblical studies has been largely an exercise in native exegesis, and that this is especially true of the study of Paul's letters, though there are some exceptions to this generalization. Yet, I don't think I would so sharply differentiate biblical studies from religious studies on this score in quite the way that Smith does. From my admittedly limited and somewhat provincial perspective, as someone with graduate training in religious studies department and now employed in a department of history, the academic discipline of religious studies itself seems to me to be largely an affair of native exegesis, but the native's adherence is to what I've called normative religious pluralist orthodoxy. I think this is why I never really understood the split between the SBL and the AAR. The most fundamental academic divide among the members of these organizations would seem to me not to be the data set, that is, religion on the one hand and biblical literature on the other, but rather issues of theoretical orientation and methodology. This is a divide that quite clearly cuts across both organizations. The difference between, on the one hand, those who view religion as a natural category native to all cultures across the globe and throughout history, to be simply described and compared, and those, on the other hand, who view religion as an explicitly second-order or redescriptive category to be used for exploring and explaining various human phenomena. This seems to me to be a much more fundamental division among the members of the AAR and the SBL. It's a difference of approach that our academic societies ought to discuss together more openly, and I offer my gratitude to the organizers of this forum for making a start in that direction. So, thank you.
Thank you very much. The next speaker is Professor Karen King, who is originally from Montana, I learned recently. And her bachelor's degree was indeed in religious studies at the University of Montana. And she came to the Brown University to earn a PhD in history of religions, focusing particularly on early Christianity. She's been teaching at Harvard Divinity School, where she is now, as of year 2009, Hollis Professor of Divinity, which happens to be the oldest endowed chair in the United States. So the Professor King has published publication includes, for example, What is Gnosticism? The Secret Revelation of John, and The Gospel of Mary of Magdala, Jesus and the First Woman Apostle. It's very convenient when I can just rattle off the name of titles of the books and you can sort of see the scope of each individual speaker's scholarship. She's currently working on three books, she tells me. One is Martyrdom and Its Discontents, and the second one entitled Ambivalent Revelation, Sex and Gender in Ancient Christianity, and thirdly, a commentary on a Gospel of Mary. So happy to Welcome, Professor King.
Thank you for the invitation, and thank you particularly for setting up this forum for discussion of biblical studies and the modern invention of religion. Certainly, biblical studies and religious studies, as at least we practice them at the SBL and the AAR, are, in my mind, deeply and mutually implicated in a web of institutional, social, and intellectual relations, as the other organizers of the, as the organizer of the panel suggested and as the other papers have implicated. SBL and AAR are also, I think, institutionalized exemplars of the history of Bible and religion, their rhetorics, their tensions, and their problematics. And the very fact that we have these two kinds of organizations says something already indicates to us much of the history of the biblical and the religious. They both, for example, arose the concept of religion, the modern concept of the biblical scholar, the comparative study of world religions and the rise of historical criticism in biblical studies. At the same time, they're concurrent and intertwined. The contexts, for example, of colonialism are crucial for both, not only in their formative periods, but in continuing practices, effects, shifting forms, and aftermaths. Both originally, at least, set themselves apart from dogmatic strictures and ecclesiastical authorities. And both tell us something about an institutional move from the church to the university. And with that institutional shift, one also sees various attempts to bring religion into the prestige of science, and particularly the taking up of an ethics of objectivity and impartiality. You know, in saying all this, I'm already embarrassed, you know, about the generalizing nature of several centuries of work. But the idea is to, at least, is to set up a kind of logic for the remarks to follow. This ethics is said to mark the difference between interested theology and disinterested religious studies. Current rhetoric, however, sets religious studies over against the study of religion, coding biblical studies quite often as theological and interested, religious studies as secular and scientific, even in the face of evidence that such rhetoric is inadequate as a description for the actual practices of both of these fields, larger fields of study. If we were to turn and look then at analytic orientation and methods, it becomes that here too, biblical studies and religious studies interact in ways that are linked, if sometimes in parallel rather than in concert. For the sake of compression, I want to glance really briefly at three issues of comparison, of phenomenology, and of history. I mean, certainly comparative approaches to the history of religion have operated to challenge much of Christianity and the privileged position that Christianity has institutionally, socially, and intellectually. And that, in turn, has led to defensive strategies that in various ways have asserted the superiority and the uniqueness of Christianity in the way that Liz already pointed out, or in typologies of religion that we are quite familiar with, beginning with animism and so forth, and working up to the highest levels and standards of religion. Somehow Christianity always turns out to be at the top. But these defensive strategies, I want to argue, were largely enabled by studies of world religions, in that although certainly sometimes the study of world religions has led to appreciation for their antiquity, for their intellectual sophistication, for their ethics, early on in particularly, they fed most often the denigration of the other as primitive or orientalizing. And now one can see better how the discourses of world religions were operating under the regime of Western colonialism, with its investment in Christianity as emblematic of Western superiority more broadly. So that with the criticism of Western colonialism has come a concurrent critique within the study of religion itself about how the so-called world religions were constituted as isms, were in fact creating to serve certain kinds of colonizing efforts, if not missionizing efforts. Now, such defensive efforts on the part of biblical studies were not consigned merely to the treatment of the non-Christian as inferior and so forth, but one sees how these kinds of debates also were disputes among Christians over how to define Christianity. So we see similar sorts of strategies being used in both directions, for the internal as well as with regard to external. And here, the invention, for example, of Gnosticism, another ism, in the 18th century allows one to see how the strategy of the discourses of orthodoxy and heresy, whether or not those terms are actually used, and usually we see them shooed, were actually replicated in 19th and 20th century historiography, as I tried to work out in and illustrate in my book, What is Gnosticism? The difficult and never resolved but constantly belabored question of how to define Gnosticism was thoroughly enmeshed in Orientalism, in the history of religion school, in Protestant anti-Catholicism, and in anti-Judaism, as it is now in New Age spiritualities, and is popular in certain kinds of criticism of Christianity as an institutional religion, as dogmatic, and as spiritually vacuous. Now, one move made to protect Christianity, that is to say, once it became clear that comparative study is not going to prove either the uniqueness nor the superiority of Christianity, one move made was, I think, phenomenology, which would assert that religion in the singular is sui generis or is some kind of transhistorical essence. And as Masuzawa has shown in her lovely book on the invention of world religions, that move allowed the truth and the universality of Christianity to be asserted as inner experience beyond historical criticism or any other real kind of analysis. And I might add that it would be interesting to know or to talk about whether indeed the newly scientized cognitive science, which is showing the universal aspects of human cognition, is just another kind of strategy in this regard. On the other hand, as Stephen Moore and Yvonne Sherwood have argued in their lovely book, The Invention of the Biblical Scholar, the continued existence in continued insistence on the ethics of impartiality and distance in historical analysis, which very much still dominates biblical studies, has worked to block criticism of the intellectual and ethical inadequacies of the biblical world, filled with divine tyranny, genocide, slavery, sexism, homophobia, among other things. In this way, they argue, a scientific positionality also blocks social political engagement and even theology, since these are manifestly not impartial activities. In these ways, then, the methods of comparison, of phenomenology, and of history have worked both in biblical studies and in religious studies, both to criticize and to support Christian superiority, and to invent religion as something sui generis, that is, beyond criticism, something subject to an ethics of tolerance, and sometimes to patterns of mutual isolation that impede our understanding, interaction, as well as critical and constructive kinds of engagement. Now, lest we think that all this is behind us and we have moved on to other places, I want to talk about the isomorphism, in a way, of the way in which varieties of early Christianity are treated and the ways in which we speak of pluralism of world religions. That is to say, how do strategic discourses operate for engaging difference or differences? It's now very much a commonplace recognized in the field of ancient Christian historiography to speak of, quote, the diversity of early Christianity, the varieties of early Christianity, and to characterize that diversity in terms of multiple Christianities. This nomenclature most frequently refers to differentiated types, whether represented as discrete social groups or distinctive theological perspectives, systems, or factions. Scholars speak very readily of Pauline or Johannine Christianity, of Jewish Christianity, and Gnosticism, and debate the precise contours of such groups, their practices, beliefs, and histories. What I think is oddest is the relative equanimity with which such characterizations are so widely embraced among academic scholars of otherwise quite different ideological persuasions and ideological and theological commitments seems to me very surprising. But closer inspection, I think, shows that scholars mean very different things and have quite different aims in view when they use this language. Although the general banner under which all this labor occurs in biblical studies is largely that of improving the accuracy of historical narrative and remedying some of its grosser partialities, the varied attempts to represent early Christian differences serve actually a variety of different contemporary social political ends, such that devising new ways to set normative boundaries, in other words, to be able to talk about what constitutes the true Christian, the false Christian, and so forth, or trying to promote ecumenism, trying to negotiate the tensions and the possibilities of religious pluralism, resisting exclusivist, so-called intolerant truth claims, or engaging in multicultural identity politics. Now, for some people, those who hold that the early church properly provides a model for contemporary Christianity, much can be at stake precisely in how ancient difference is represented. For others, telling the story of Christianity differently can offer opportunities for extending or critiquing Christianity's impact on contemporary social and political life, or perhaps opening up space to imagine better social arrangements, such as we see in the work of Burton Mack. The shared language of diversity of early Christianity is thus not about one thing, but it covers a variety of discrete, overlapping, incongruous, and sometimes conflicting methods, aims, theoretical orientations, and institutional fields. Now, the potential for disruption here, potential for the way in which Bauer, for example, used and talked about Christianity in its different forms, I want to argue has largely been domesticated. And I'm very interested in talking about this one strategy. It certainly doesn't cover by any means, I hope I've just made that clear, that people are doing very different things when they talk about varieties of Christianity. But one of these strategies is certainly to domesticate the possibility, the potentials for the disruptive character of difference. The main strategy that's used to do this, arguably, is to resolve all the varieties of early Christianity into two groups, varieties of the same and varieties of the different. Now, varieties of the same is to assert some core or some essence, sometimes historical, sometimes transcendent, of which all the material historical cases are merely variant expressions suited to particular social historical contexts. In some way, we saw Philip Schaff already beginning this kind of move. Or, on the other hand, we have varieties of the really different. Okay? And here it turns out that the former category, varieties of the same, are entirely co-identical with the New Testament canon, while irresolvable differences belong to groups traditionally classified as heretics or outsiders, Jews and pagans. And now, of course, the same strategy can be used to support Christian ecumenism within limits, while excluding world religions as all different, both from Christianity and from each other. Now, this shows how it's possible, I think, to combine the notion of singularity, if not uniqueness or essence, with historical analysis of diversity in order to domesticate diversity, in order to domesticate difference. Similarly, one might argue that religion in the singular, again, whether regarded as sui generis or a transcendental essence or as something which one can describe phenomenologically, is often used not just to assert the value of all the varied historical expressions of religion in their pluralistic wonder, but to allow them to continue as independent, non-interacting, bounded worlds of their own, the capacity to corral and therefore to control. This strategy reproduces the notion of unity or uniformity as positive and difference or diversity as negative, but does so while officially celebrating diversity. So too with the category world religions. The notion of religion as a unifying essence or singularity, marking, by the way, the rationale of religion as having its own discipline, something in which we have some financial investment as well as other kinds of investment. The notion of religion as a unifying essence or singularity, of which there are multiple diverse expressions, also has the capacity to seem to celebrate and to respect difference, while yet allowing for well-bounded traditions to be treated separately, and to be treated comparatively only in certain ways, and thus to domesticate fully the ways that don't foundationally challenge either our areas of expertise within the academy or our separate theological, ideological, religious perspectives and practices. As Tomoko Masuzawa has argued, the notion of world religions is foundationally a discourse of othering, and that should make us very interested, okay, in precisely what we're doing with categories about difference in the celebration of diversity. What happens then if taboos against critical and constructive engagement with each other, that is, against doing theology or ethics or politics across these boundaries, are strictly held in place under particular notions? For example, methodological strictures or sensibilities like tolerance. How to get out of this cycle? We need to think about a usable definition of religion that allows differences and similarities to stand and be responsibly addressed through comparative analysis, that allows for changes, instabilities, blurry boundaries, historical contextualization, and that allows for critical and constructive engagement, that is, ethics, politics, and theology, ideology, social and critical thinking to work. Now, I am profoundly moved by Moore and Sherwood, as well as by Masuzawa, in writing the history of the invention of world religions on the one hand, and the invention of the biblical scholar, in ways that invite us to engage critically and constructively through what Moore and Sherwood call metacritical analyses of our disciplinary pasts, unquote. Such perspectives might very well help us move beyond passionate but intellectually vacuous, polarizing rhetorics that are our legacy, but hopefully not our future. Can we not better engage critically and constructively in the world, not within the academy, but we actually live in a world, by doing so here with each other? I think so, I hope so. Now, a certain amount of all of this came into view with the AARSBL split. And while some of us had actually thought that biblical studies was fully embedded in the broad compass of the academic study of religion, others felt more strongly the legacy and the current realities of Christianity's hegemony. And within that, the special status of the Bible felt perhaps with particular acuity in North America. It's not that paralyzing hostility and polarization, silences and refusals to engage will get us nowhere. It's that they are taking us places we may very well agree that we do not wish to go. I hope that the return of AAR and SBL to the same time and space, if not yet to a shared program book, let alone to my hope that one day there will only be one society, that this return after considered time apart will initiate the kind of conversations that we so badly need. Given the enormity of changes marked under terms like pluralism, multiculturalism, globalism, transnationalism, isms, isms, and more isms, which include, amongst other things, demographic shifts, challenges to secularization, questions about the status of religion, and indeed the humanities in higher education, in retrospect, it's no surprise to see tensions within the academy. And indeed, it's good to have them surface to the level of transparent discussion and engagement. I hope that sessions like this one can be a place where precisely we were able to take up the topic of the role of biblical studies within modern academic formations of the study of religion. Thank you.
Our next and penultimate speaker is Professor Halvor Moxnes. He's a professor of New Testament in the Faculty of Theology at the University of Oslo. His many publications include Putting Jesus in His Place, A Radical Vision of Household and Kingdom, and Constructing Early Christian Families, Family as Social Reality and Metaphor. His latest monograph, just out in England and soon here, is entitled Jesus and the Rise of Nationalism, A New Quest for the 19th Century Historical Jesus. Professor Moxnes.
And what I try to do in that book is to look at historical Jesus studies as the intersection between biblical studies and religious studies in terms of what they share in terms of cultural, political, anthropological contexts. I'll give a few examples of how I see this happening in the 19th century in a way that also shapes the scholarship in the 20th century. I think my thesis is that when biblical scholarship is not aware of and discusses this common cultural, political, social presuppositions, they lose the contact with religious studies and lose the possibility of interaction. Biblical scholarship and the formations of religious and cultural paradigms in the 19th century. My first example there is Strauss' famous Life of Jesus Critically Examined, a book of 800 pages of detailed philological study of the relations between texts in New Testament about Jesus, and where he found that they were not historical, but myths. And how come that 800 pages of detailed philological argumentation created such discussion and also such political either support or criticism? That was partly because the conclusions he drew from this type of study. If the stories of Jesus were not divine but myths by the communities, that gave authority to the community and shifted the representation of the divine from one person to the community, to people in general. And this shows how philological studies was really part of a larger, also political type of movement. The 19th century represented the beginning and the development of the philological Bible studies, particularly in terms of source criticism and of their historical value. And the discussion of the synoptic problem and the historic value of John's Gospel was matters of intense discussion among German Protestant biblical scholars. And there were also signs of the liberal stand and therefore political independence of German universities at the time. And when then the result of these discussions were that the Synoptic Gospels and not John were the main sources for the historical Jesus, then also how they presented Jesus became important in terms of paradigms of interpretation of religion. So if Jesus was supported in Galilee but killed in Jerusalem, that opened up the possibility to look at the symbolic reference of Galilee, of Jerusalem. Galilee stood for everything that was positive, that was good. Jerusalem for everything that was negative. So they became metaphors for good and bad, respectively, that could be historicized and applied to contemporary conflicts between Christians and Jews, Protestants and Roman Catholics, North Germany, that Prussia, and South Germany, Austria. So the historical Jesus was also related to geography and Orientalism. The divine Christ lived in heaven, but the earthly Jesus had a specific place in Palestine. So the interest in the historical Jesus corresponded with a growing interest in the Holy Land, both for scholarly explorations initiated by Napoleon and the scholars he brought with him on the Egyptian and Syrian expedition, also by Bible and history scholars who traveled in the Holy Land, and also ordinary tourists like Mark Twain, who was not an ordinary tourist, but he described how middle-class tourists experienced Palestine. And Ernst Renan, who wrote his Life of Jesus in 1863, gave an illuminating explanation or example of the importance of this interest in the land, because he said he had found a new source in addition to the four Gospels. I had before my eyes a fifth Gospel, and that was the places where everything happened. So the land geography became a source in itself, so that the land became an interpretive resource for the interpretation of Jesus. And this was based on the very common presupposition in all cultural studies in the 19th century, that nature influenced people. They were shaped by people. And Renan gives an illuminating example of that when he describes Jesus' sort of view from Nazareth, where he could see in Galilee from the top, the kingdom of God in contrast to the dreariness of Judea that lay to the south. And these differences in language, in landscapes, were understood then as differences in religion. And that was dramatically illustrated by the British travel writer Morton in his In the Steps of the Master in the 1930s, very popular travel writer. And he reads the view towards the south, towards ancient Samaria and Judea, as expressions of the Old Testament. When one turns north, however, one looks towards Galilee and the New Testament. These two directions signal two different attitudes. In the New Testament, we seem to have emerged from the dark, fiery Eastern world into a clear light that is almost European. Here come the presuppositions from the 19th century clearly to the fore. This is Orientalism. This is Europe as the progress of religion. The third example is the historical Jesus as the great man of the 19th century. When Friedrich Schleiermacher gave his first lectures on the historical Jesus at the University of Berlin from 1819 onwards, he introduced the term biography to characterize what he was doing. And this presentation in terms of a biography placed the historical Jesus presentations into the larger cultural context of the 19th century and the idea of the great man. Because although the historical Jesus scholars protested against the dogmatic Christ, they still preserved the idea of Jesus as an exemplary human being, as an extraordinary person who not only embodied Europe, but was the moral example and the example of progress of humanity. And in order to find an adequate expression of that, they used the category of heroes as great men, which was the popular idea of history in the 19th century that was sort of driven forward by single individuals, great men, the heroes of the time, among others then the philosophers of the Greek antiquity, and also kings of antiquity, and then now also Jesus. He represented progress in history, both in terms of European civilization, vis-a-vis the primitive state of the Orient and Africa, and also in terms of the discussion of religious studies and the classification of religions. One model was based on the distinction between natural religion, representing a lower level, and higher religion. And these higher religions could also be sort of classified and separated in different groups. The American Sanskrit scholar Whitney held that there was a decisive division between religions that developed from and were restricted by one race community, like Judaism, and religions then had an individual founder, for instance, Christianity. And this is exactly the model that Renan uses in his life of Jesus. So he portrays the conflict between Jesus and the Jewish leaders in this terms. So the division between ideal humanity on the side of Jesus and a religion that was based on the distinctions of blood and race, exemplified by the Jewish leaders. So he writes, he, Jesus, proclaimed the rights of man, not the rights of the Jew, the religion of man, not the religion of the Jew, the deliverance of man, not the deliverance of the Jew. And here Renan's understanding of true religion becomes visible as a religion for all humanity. And a religion based on race, on the other hand, signified particularity. In Renan's presentation, Jesus and Judaism are turned into types, paradigm examples that could also be applied to contemporary situations. For example, when Renan discusses the basis for a nation in his famous lecture on what is a nation, in humanity, it could be based on humanity that transcends race. And here, humanity stands for the French idea of the nation compared to the German idea of the nation based on race and blood, whereas the French nation was based on participation, sharing a history, and sharing a willingness for the future of a nation. So, historical Jesus studies in the 19th century, they were based on biblical studies, and they were part of the scholarly development of those studies, like source criticism, tradition criticism, and so forth. But to construct Jesus as a unique personality that shaped Europe, historical Jesus scholars had to interact with contemporary knowledge of society, anthropology, for instance, ideas of progress, ideal figures, common perceptions of race, interactions between nature and people. That is, all of these presuppositions that underlie constructions and ideas of religion. The contemporary scene of historical Jesus studies share many of the same perspectives as that of the 19th century. Source criticism still play an important part, maybe not so much with the contrast between Synoptics and John, but between constructions based primarily on the canonical Gospels and those that also draw on other sources, like the Gospel of Thomas, Peter, and Q. And even today, the discussion of the historical Jesus is to a large extent the discussion of historical Galilee, where studies of archaeology, urbanization, pottery production and trade play an important part. And even today, the great man's unique personality is an underlying paradigm of many presentations of Jesus, with almost the only alternative is feminist interpretation, voicing a critical perspective with their focus on movement and collectivity. However, in these historical Jesus studies today, there seems to be little awareness and definitely little discussion of these larger contexts of models and ideological issues for constructing the historical Jesus, for instance, in terms of post-colonialism, nationalism, gender constructions. And this leaves the historical Jesus studies today as a niche, particularly in the relationship between theology and church, but not interacting with a larger discussion of what is religion, which I think they should do. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Our final speaker, concluding speaker, is a historian. Professor Suzanne Marchand is professor of history at Louisiana State University, who, I might say, happily recently discovered how much religion scholars love her work and finding it so useful. She is an intellectual historian of specializing modern intellectual history, focused particularly in Germany of the 19th and 20th century. I first actually learned of Suzanne Marchand's work through Susanna Heschel, who highly recommended her first book, Down from Olympus, the Archaeology and Philhellenism in Germany, 1750 to 1970. And there she dealt very much of, through her characteristic, meticulous scholarship, told us a lot about the development of the Altertumswissenschaft, classical scholarship in Germany, and which made all the more make me anticipate with a great hope for her next book, which came out a couple of years ago, German Orientalism in the Age of the Empire, Religion, Race, and Scholarship, which was published in 2009. And I could not wait for another year before the paperback version came out. And I think, many of the books that I cited on this occasion, including Liz's, in fact, Liz Clark's book on founding the fathers, and Suzanne's book, will be sitting. It's one of those books that one would not be easily done with, but be sitting next to works such as Raymond Schwab's Oriental Renaissance, and I know that they will sit there for the rest of my scholarly life. So it's my pleasure to introduce our last speaker, Suzanne Marchand.
Thanks so much, Tomoko. As it happens, this paper is about how I learned to love religious studies, so I can return the compliment. In the beginning, there was one great scholarly continent inhabited by Christian Europeans interested in reading books and allergic to practical careers, theology. It was a continent of many interconnected and overlapping lands, but I want to focus on four of those neighboring or interlapping and interlocking lands today: biblical studies, religion, Oriental philology, and classical philology, about which I will say the least about classical philology, as it was classical philology, in fact, which caused this continent to break up, I believe, caused the breakup in the 18th century as it made its way into a secular frame and tried to do its best to dissociate itself from the theological faculty in the German universities. The other three of those great continental lands, biblical studies, Oriental philology, and the study of religion, continued to remain together, and I think do continue to remain together even now, and perhaps share so much that it will be indeed hard for them to break up in reality. In part, they still share, of course, that humanistic method, philology, and its understanding of texts, its dependence on texts, and also they share iconoclastic and orthodox dialectics, the process by which heterodox visions or ideas force orthodox recoveries or defenses, and by no means do I mean to say that the biblical studies are always the ones in the orthodox camp. Often they're not, as some members of the in this paper will show. I want today to give you just a very short interview of how I learned to understand Oriental scholarship in the context of this larger continent of humanistic, theological, religious, philological scholarship, and to try to show what it allowed me to understand about the German world that I had not understood before, especially as I had hoped and thought that I would write a book exclusively about the later 19th century and about Germany and its modern colonies and so on, and discovered indeed my story had to be much longer, older, and richer as well, and consequently took 13 years rather than the 5 I thought I was going to spend. Perhaps I switched on my new critical faculties and off some of those old tried and true Saidian paradigms when I met Justus Olshausen. He was an Oriental philologist and biblical exegete, a man who had lost his professorship at the University of Kiel after rashly throwing in his lot with the 1848 revolutionaries. After 1849, Olshausen was forbidden from reoccupying his post and reduced to eking out a living as a librarian until his death in 1883. Although he devoted many years to the study of Indian languages, he never finished a book on the subject, as he could not satisfy himself that he had done sufficient linguistic work to ground a major study. I think this was the sentence in an elegy written for him by a friend that got to me. Quote, "Even in the last weeks before he became fatally ill, Olshausen occupied himself with a study of sound shifts in Pahlavi," end of quote. Suddenly, I could picture a person, a lonely old man, working at his desk by night, trying to get his grammar right. But there were other interesting, and it seems to me now, very typical things about Olshausen. His father had been a pastor. That was how Olshausen had learned to read Hebrew. He had learned little from his university professors, one of whom had refused to lecture to an audience of one, and the other of whom had been too busy with his menial job at a library to teach Olshausen. Olshausen's first book in 1826 had been titled Emendations to the Old Testament, and one elegist wrote that Olshausen's efforts to free the scriptures from the slag which had covered them in the course of the centuries typified his lifelong ambition. First, to establish the essence of Old Testament Hebraism, first to establish the essence of Old Testament Hebraism on the basis of a text purified and fixed in this way, and then to establish its linguistic relations. That was already his aim, and it remained his aim until his death. And I can't go into why Pahlavi was connected to this, but even his efforts to try to understand the wider world of Indian religions was clearly related to his Old Testament inquiries. His life's aim, that is to say, by someone who understood him well, was consistent with those of the 16th century Christian humanists like Erasmus or even Luther himself. These biographical tidbits gave me pause, and I began to wonder if, in my rush to find orientalizing discourses, I had failed to appreciate the role religion in general, and biblical criticism in particular, continued to play in German scholarship, and had shut out the lived experience and explicit aims of the people who wrote, spoke, and cared most about the Orient in the 19th century, otherwise known as Orientalists. It was at that point that I began to notice a pattern of heterodoxy in my subjects and their out-of-the-way career trajectories. Martin Haug, the mid-century Persian scholar who was celebrated amongst the Parsis of Pune, who thanked him for having helped them launch a Zoroastrian Reformation. There was Arminius Vambery, who dressed as a dervish and begged his way from Istanbul to Bukhara in the 1860s, partly because he had a flair for self-dramatization and partly because he was broke. I began to notice how often my Orientalists recounted being lonely, having so few students, like Friedrich Rückert, that no one noticed when they failed to show up for classes, being teased, as was Franz Bopp, for devoting himself to anything other than classical languages, being the only representative of the discipline in the country, as was still the Assyriologist Franz Delitzsch in the 1870s. There was a constant refrain: the classicists don't respect us, the theologians don't despise us, the public couldn't be bothered to care about the East, except when the Old Testament is concerned. But even more importantly, I noticed how very long-lasting was the Orientalist attachment not just to the Bible as a source, but to the Bible as a text whose clearing up or de-slagifying, to use Olhausen's term, was the great goal of their careers. It was in this mood that I discovered the following passage written by a semi-dilettante Indologist reviewing the work of Max Müller in 1907. The longing for the Orient, quotation, the longing for the Orient accompanies the Occidental from the cradle to the grave. When the young farmer's wife of the far west, deep in the most remote forest valley of the Rocky Mountains, rocks her firstborn child on her lap and imparts to him the elements of the Christian faith, she tells him about the shepherds of Bethlehem in the land of Judea, far, far on the other side of the Atlantic Ocean. She tells him about the star, which the wise men from the land of Chaldea followed, and then of the rivers of the Nile and the Euphrates, of Mount Ararat, on which Noah's Ark came to rest after the flood, of Mount Sinai, from which Moses brought the earliest tablets of the law to the people of Israel, of the great cities of Nineveh, Babylon, Tyrus and Sidon, the world conquerors, Cyrus of Persia, and Pharaoh in Egypt land. The Bible is, and this continues the quotation, the Bible is the book through which the world of the West, even in the times of the most melancholy isolation, remains persistently tied to the Orient. Even when one ignores its character as a sacred book of revelation and examines it from a historical and geographical standpoint, the Bible can be seen as a world historical book of wonders, as the book which ever again awakens and reawakens in the Aryans of the West, and I'll go back to Aryans in a moment, who have deserted their homeland, that longing for the Orient which binds people together, end of quote. This author then turned to sketch the origins and history of European Oriental studies, which he attributed to the religious need of educated persons in the West and to the Reformation. In spite of being an Indologist, our author didn't mention Europe's actual influence in India or anywhere else in the world. His focus was clearly and exclusively on religious need. Of course, it would be an enormous mistake to ignore the history of Europe's actual conquests and extractions from Asia in the period between 1750 and 1970 and the whole missionary experience that goes with it. We can't ignore the condensations and expropriations that followed or tied in myriad ways the history of European and American Oriental studies to that imperial project. But our scholarship has been blinkering itself in a different way, and when I say that, I'm talking about modern cultural history, not religious studies scholars. But our scholarship has been blinkering itself in a different way, and that is by pretending that educated Europeans after the French Revolution didn't care anymore about religion and the Bible, and all believed that the West was spiritually as well as materially more advanced than the East. Recognizing that at least until 1914, the Bible remained in various ways, quote, the world historical book of wonders, the book which ever reawakened Western longing to know the Orient, was what finally woke me up and quickly realized that the books that I need to read, the books that I really found helpful, that opened the doors to understanding what German Orientalism was actually about, were books not written by my fellow historians, but written by scholars of religious studies like Hans Kippenberg or Susanna Heschel or Jonathan Smith or Tomoko Masuzawa or Jonathan Sheehan or Guy Strumsa. I'm still woefully ignorant here, but planning many happy years of reading and self-stretching to remedy my long years of wandering in the wilderness. Even though I have to say I was put in room number 1789, which I think was an attempt to pull me back to the French Revolution. The book about the German Orientalism that I wrote then emphasizes not empire and not the study of the modern fallen cultures of the Near and Far East, though that is in the book and others have rightly understood and emphasized its importance. But I understand something that I think was largely missing from modern historians' understanding of the 19th century and even of the 20th century, and that is the ongoing and deeply important intertwining of this culture with the Bible and with biblical criticism and its enmity, in fact, from classical philology, which became rigorously secularized and ignored all of those Hellenistic texts it despised as being written in Greek, Silver Greek, and full of too many strange and scary Oriental and irrational ideas. Unquestionably, the study of the Bible, the study of the Oriental philology and religion had a great bearing also on racial theory. And though I don't have time to go into my argument here today, I think that we need to look more closely at the Aryan question in light of the search for the first and original religion. It seems to me that there is far more here to follow up on than we have previously thought, and in line with one of the previous speakers who said that the Darwinist challenge has been overrated with respect to the biblical one, I would fully agree. Certainly, there were endless numbers of these kinds of quests in Germany in the 19th century to try to find the first original religion, to find the spark of revelation, to find the world's most ancient Oriental books, and that quest marks and continues German cultural history right down through the end of the 19th century. It certainly characterizes the work of people like Paul de Lagarde, certainly also I think Max Müller, maybe Tomoko would agree, and of Leopold von Schroeder, and of numerous other people at the fin de siècle. We can also see the long-lasting power of the reading and critique of the Bible in the forming of alternative spirituality and what we might call New Age culture at the fin de siècle. And here we could witness many of those books written about Jesus and Buddha, and also the German Christian attempt to square Nietzsche's famous Also Sprach Zarathustra with fragments of the scriptures. As Stephen Asheim showed some time ago, in fact, numerous Germans quite absurdly decided that Nietzsche's intent was to lay the groundwork for a strong rather than a weak Christianity and continued to pursue the idea of a real Zarathustra by means of incorporating Persian religion, the Bible, and Aryan theory. Further proof, indeed, of the pervasiveness of the Bible can be found in other parts of late 19th century German cultural history, including the now forgotten novels of Georg Ebers, an Egyptologist who wrote historical fiction, especially for young girls, about the Hellenistic world. The first volume of these has 723 footnotes. It's really quite a read. And on the whole, I think there is simply far more for us to discover in this late 19th century than we might have previously thought. There was indeed a tremendous amount of rethinking about time, about the depths of time. I think that, again, had very little, in fact, to do with Darwin, at least in German circumstances, where Darwin was particularly received by the left and not by the university right-oriented scholarly world. Here, the rethinking of historical time had very much to do with the deepening of Oriental time through archaeology, Orientalist scholarship, and the critique of the Bible. I think it's there that you see really the opening up of deep and empty spaces, those that Thomas Mann would find and characterize in the opening to his Joseph novels, by the way, based on the book of Genesis, quote, very deep as the well of the past, shall we not call it bottomless? This revolution in time for laypersons, too, I think was very much an outcome of biblical criticism rather than Darwinism. And I would link it to the uptick in searches for non-biblical revelation and racial purification. German culture was shaken to its roots by the intersection of theology, Oriental philology, and classics, not just once in Luther's day, but in successive waves, of which the immediate pre-1914 tsunami was perhaps just one, but remains the least understood. I've learned a great deal then by trying to understand the humanist and exegetical sides of German Orientalism over the long durée from the Reformation to the 1920s. I've also learned very much by watching the interaction between biblical and classical scholarship over this period. It's a relationship that was always uneasy and in fact became one of great enmity, though there's also much to be learned by noting that these two projects dovetailed once again in the work of some iconoclastic scholars in the 1890s and forward. There's also much to be learned about things that were not studied much in German academe, that is post-biblical Judaism and Far Eastern languages and cultures, in part, I think, because those could not be connected directly to the Old Testament or even to the New. Inquiry into relationships between biblical and non-biblical archaeology in this period is also something we need to pursue more deeply. And there are a host of individual careers waiting to be studied in detail, such as the theologian and scholar of Gnosticism, Wilhelm Busset, or Albrecht Dietrich, a classicist who wrote a study of a Mithraic liturgy, as well as a cult Germanophile classic entitled Mutter Erde. Example of someone who crossed all of those disciplines all of the time. We will not get far in understanding these people or in understanding these disciplinary relationships unless we try our best to reconstitute that continent that I evoked in the beginning, the continent of four and more disciplines. And as we begin to reconstitute that continent, I hope you will also invite to join with you in the reconstitution effort modern German historians as well. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Well, we have half an hour or so still left for conversation, and for which those of you who are in the audience, I hope, will join in soon. I think it's truly a rich array of papers, presentations today, and glad that the number of items really came up, and as a sort of an effort to at least as a kind of a peg to hang some of the rich material. One of the questions, aside from the perhaps somewhat predictable one of if we're talking about two different scholarly regime or domains, whether the one of the questions obviously would be that of methodology and what are the stakes for those who are studying, how interested or disinterested those scholarship might be, and that kind of question. But also, I think through a number of presentations, the question of philology came up. What is the status of philology? And somewhat related to it, what does it mean to be so obsessed about written texts? That would be another issue. And also, especially in the last two presentations, the question of the fact that so much of the biblical scholarship, at least in the 19th century, more and more, it became very pronouncedly identifiable as Semitic studies. And in fact, many positions of scholarship is identified as such, and what is the status of that scholarship in relation to increasingly Arianizing conception of European Christendom. That seems to be a really a part of it. And I just wanted to take the liberty of my position to add one more thing that is sort of related to that one, is that it seems to me, this is a very kind of amateur observation, but from 19th century to 20th century, right at that turn of the century seemed to be a kind of a disaggregation of certain body of scholarship, such that in 20th century we have almost, as a matter of course, biblical studies, Jewish studies, and Islamic studies as somewhat distinct domains, and not much seemed to be going on in terms of, for example, I mean, looking at the American Academy of Religion meetings. Those are very distinctly separate domains. And this seems to be a kind of a disaggregation that happened from 19th to 20th century. So that's a kind of a question that I think it might be interesting to ask. So I wondered if, should I ask any on the panel who may have some response to other people's presentations? So all the microphones are apparently alive, so.
I'd be willing to listen to
them. Okay, so there are also three microphones on the floor, and we'll welcome your comments and questions.
Hi, thanks. This was a great panel. This question is directed primarily to Karen King because of your comments about this paradigm of the varieties of Christianity, but of course anybody on the panel can answer it. This is something that's been puzzling me for a while, the relationship to this model and a desire for the dialogue with ecumenism and pluralism. Why is it, do you think, that that this model is evoked? Because when we look at these varieties of Christianities that we encounter through the texts of people writing to them or about them, they're not really engaged in an ecumenical or pluralistic spirit very often. They're very often quarreling with one another, and the authors that we're reading are trying to determine which kinds of conflict are okay, which kinds of disagreements are okay. But many, very often, most of them are not, right? So why is this model of varieties of Christianity evoked? How can you explain that?
Yeah, I suppose that I think of it historically. You know, when Bauer just first started talking about the varieties of early Christianity, and he moved away from the paradigm that had been operative in biblical studies, where the Bible was understood as a whole, you know, and every part interpreted every other part, and God wrote it, and so it all said one thing. And historically, already to ask about authorship and to start looking at the differences, you know, in amongst the New Testament text showed up these differences in theology and tendencies and so forth. And then I think it had to be dealt with. You know, so once you have it there, the question was what to do with it, and I think the pushback there was partially precisely to work through, as I think other panelists talked about, the issues about authority. You know, as well, Philip Schaff I thought was a great example of this kind of material, but there's also a real way in which if the question of differences can't be gotten rid of. You know, if they're simply there, then how do you deal with them? How do you make them work for you, so to speak? And I think that this is where, you know, people who are interested in ecumenism, it's very helpful to be able to talk about varieties, yet under a common unity, you know, something that works together. So I think the politics of that make I suppose it's a way of talking about situation on the ground of actual differences and trying to make them work, but then holding back from letting differences actually become problematic in foundational kinds of ways. I don't know if that's answering your question at all.
Well, it would be more helpful in an ecumenical dialogue if all of these early varieties of Christianities were not quarreling with one another about the fact that there was variety, right?
I'm sorry, I didn't hear what you said. If they weren't correlated with one another?
If they were not quarreling, if they were not fighting over their own diversity in the text that we encounter them in, then that it would be a much more useful resource for an ecumenical or a pluralistic dialogue, right?
But they do fight with each other a lot. You know, and arguably the discourse about difference, though, I think moves from the early Christianity where there, the way it's talked about is in terms of factionalism. That's what you get already in the Pauline letters and so forth, are factions. And that is what shifts, you know, this positive notion of right. There's no positive notion about factional difference in early Christianity. It's always something that has to be overcome, worked out, unified, etc. Or
right.
Excluded,
right.
Yeah.
Yep, that's the genesis for my puzzlement over this.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I'll jump in on that same point. I really liked your categorization of varieties of same and varieties of different in the discussion of early Christianity. I find that really, really helpful, and it's been kind of twisting around in my head. And with that question, one of the things that I think can be helpful for us in thinking about this issue of variety and pluralism with early Christianity is allowing these other comparisons that would break that sort of boundedness that you were talking about. So something like in Pliny's epistle, the group of Christians he describes in Upper Asia Minor in Bithynia, you know, their practices, they get together, they sing a song, they have dinner, there's no reading, no texts are mentioned, and this, if you compared that group with other groups and looked at someone like Paul, who seems to be highly textual, you know, interested in Hebrew scriptures and focused on that, his similarities would be more with other textually oriented groups, whereas the crowd in Bithynia would be classed with groups doing all sorts of different practices. So I think, yeah, there's quite a bit of fruitfulness to be had by pressing on that issue more in the way that you started.
Okay, thank you. Go ahead.
Hi, this is partly a comment prompted by Tomoko's observations. But also think it runs through some of the presentations. That is to say, I think we need more carefully to attend to the difference between elites and ordinary folk. That is between the scholars, whom the Oriental scholars who had, admittedly, as we heard, had one or two or no students, and what was going on in training clergy, for example, and preaching, everyday preaching. So in that sense, I think to talk about the Arianization of European Christianity in this period is, I think, anachronistic. In that, if there was Arianization, whether it was racist or not is a question. I don't think Max Müller was really a racist. It was certainly a matter of a concern for the elites, and it wasn't really. One can look at National Socialism as a kind of popularization of Arianism, or the political movements at the end of the 19th century, the folkish political movements of the 19th and early 20th century, as an attempt to popularize or vulgarize this kind of concept. So the question then becomes, what explains the break? What explains the disaggregation, as Tomoko mentioned? And I would suggest that we might want to think about something like the rise of neo-orthodoxy. The scholars who did both Islam and Judaism, for example, in France, were primarily Jewish in the late 19th century at the École Pratique des Etudes. The rise of neo-orthodoxy, despite what Barth would like us to believe, did produce a kind of Christian exceptionalism. So one finds in the Ecole Pratique in the fifth section that roughly around the early 1910 or so, where there were liberal Protestants who were teaching Bible as well as history of religions and teaching ethnography, like the Reveals, no longer did that at a later date after neo-orthodoxy came into flower. So it's really the demise of liberal Protestantism, the rise of neo-orthodoxy, and the neo-orthodoxy's effect on the seminary training of people that I think had a lot to do with the disaggregation of these fields.
Thank you. I thought that was a very interesting idea to focus on the demise of liberal theology. I think so too. I think there are all sorts of interesting ways in which you can see generational conflict involved there too, as a whole generation of younger scholars tries to put their cards on the table and do away with some of the older scholarship. I think that there also is certainly a very great difference between what's going on at the elite level and what's going on at the popular level. Although there is a tremendous amount, at least in Germany, this is the country I know best, there is a tremendous amount of circulation of pamphlets about world religions in one way or another, about who is Buddha and what is the relationship between India and Christianity, and there are novels being written trying to sort of work out all of these things. And I think there is a kind of breakthrough moment at which it seems like the Old Testament is just becoming a less and less focal point. Though, you know, as I see it, you know, really the Babel Bibel strike was not won by Friedrich Delitzsch. I mean, it was won by the defenders of the Hebrew Old Testament as the source of Christianity. So there is certainly a kind of neo-Orthodox resistance there. One last thing. I don't believe that a whole lot of this speculation about Aryan religions and the origin of spark of revelation in Galilee and all that stuff had all that much to do really with the Nazi movement. But Hitler did once say, all of these professors of Nordic studies, and I think the same could be said for Oriental studies, you know, that they really don't do that much for me, but if they knock out some of the basic old-fashioned Orthodox Christian belief, that'll do us some service. And I think perhaps that's the most important connection, is that it sort of disaggregates.
I also think that pointing to the new Orthodoxy is important, that responds also to Tomoko's question of why has status of Christianity, Judaism, and Islam being disintegrated and not kept together. And I think that's because the Orthodoxy of Bath emphasized that Christianity was not religion. And therefore, there was nothing to compare. And I wonder if that is also sort of visible in E.P. Sanders' comparison between Paul and Judaism, when Paul's religion becomes faith and salvation. That is a very, very specific Protestant idea of religion. So it doesn't take into consideration that Judaism could not be presented like
there's
that.
There's a paradox, however, in Barth's saying that Christianity is not a religion, and that is that Christians say that they're not like the other religions. And we are a special religion. I mean, what else is Christianity? I mean, what the assertion of Christians by the fact that Christianity is unique, other than an assertion by religious folk that their religion is incomparable. So there's a kind of a paradox. Barth produces, in some funny sense, the opposite of what he intended to produce, or may have intended to be produced.
Any others?
Yes.
I can just say the professors whose lecture notes and whose students' lecture notes in their classes I studied for the work in my book, Jesus certainly comes out as remarkably un-Jewish in the teaching in these four Protestant seminaries. They go to great efforts to show how Jesus really wasn't Jewish at all in some respects, etc. But this point we're talking about the end of the 19th century, I've started work for a new volume that will come up into the 20th century. And there seems to be some moment right in the end somewhere in the 1890s. They just stop fighting about this stuff. They don't care if Paul wrote the pastoral epistles or not. It's sort of over with, and I'm quite curious as to what that could be and how much it depends on just particular professors teaching in particular institutions and the amount of kind of influence they had there. It'll be very interesting to see about Harvard, because the person they hired to teach early Christianity in Harvard was a Roman Catholic modernist who had fled from Italy and things going on there. So I think, and then at the University of Chicago, you have a university created out of, well, you wouldn't say out of nothing, but it was just created in a way to make something new and to have a kind of graduate education that hadn't been so popularized before, et cetera. So I think there were some very different things developing right in that period from 1895 or so up to about 1915, 1920, which makes you think again, is that moment of liberalism just a very small moment that then totally got submerged in what comes afterwards, at least in the Protestant world?
Yeah, this is sort of a question out of ignorance. I'm a cultural historian. I've been working for about 40 years in general non-religious subjects, and just last couple of years I'm trying to do something on religion in the modernist period. And I'm running across a problem. I'm a phenomenologist. I like to know what things mean, and I like to be clear about it. And the more I study religion, the more I have no idea what religion is. As I read scholarship, I want to know what is the religious belief of the author. I've never had that sort of concern before. And what is the orientation? And I want to know how they use language. And I realize, after a paragraph or two, that they're using words that should be in quotation marks, as far as I'm concerned, like God and sacred and divine and Messiah. And they seem to assume that these things mean something that is empirically real. And it varies. It varies from paragraph to paragraph. It varies from chapter to chapter, even from the same author. And it's an extraordinary problem with language, and I'm getting more and more confused as I embark upon this. And I say this is out of ignorance, because you are excellent scholars. I'm really, really impressed at the knowledge. I wish I had your knowledge, because it's going to take me years to get where I want to go. But I just wonder if you're sensitive to this problem, and you're aware of it, and many of you, and because I've been here, this is the first one I've been to like this, and I've been to a bunch of panels, and no one seems to be. They seem to all know what they're talking about, and they use these terms, and they think they know what they are, and I'm thinking, there's some delusional people and who have been writing things, and we've been studying them for hundreds of years and worshiping them, and I just feel I'm in it, I'm just not sure where I am, and I wonder, because whether you have any of these concerns yourselves. So that's sort of a question and a confession. So.
Thank you. That's a lovely question. I mean, that was what I was trying to address at the beginning of my short talk, was precisely the fact that both religious studies and biblical studies, in a way that absolutely mirror each other and also mirror the problematic in broader culture, loosely defined, is precisely this: what is religion and what can possibly be the place of religion in modernity? And so we are caught in exactly those two moves that you described. So, and there's I mean, we are very, you said you kind of assumed that we would be certain about what we're talking about, and I'd say we sort of amplify that uncertainty even in a single work of scholarship and some of the people that we discussed today, let alone in all the factions and divisions within our disciplines, precisely this question about whether the sacred, the religious, is that which kind of must be abnegated and sacrificed and given up and translated into other terms, or whether it is something unique and valorized to be protected and repeated. And what I'm interested in is what that repetition of these strange old words like God and Satan and these things, what they do to our modernities and how they destabilize them. And that to me is one of the most original and interesting debates going on between some people in Bible and religion and cultural theory, is precisely this question of how, like you say, they should have scare quotes. And it's precisely the question of those scare quotes that I think is interesting for us. And I think that's a particularly intense modern problematic for us. I don't know if that's helpful. I've just mirrored your confusion.
I would like to ask our cultural historian friend whether he's equally puzzled about the meaning of the word culture. That's as fuzzy, certainly as religion is, if not fuzzier.
I was surprised that what never got mentioned was the volume of scholarship in the biblical field. Because when you think about it, people write dissertations on a verse, or just even, you could spend like 2 years reading up the bibliography on a book, And I think to my mind, that's one of the biggest barriers to the comparative project, is just that sheer depth of scholarship there. Not like that there isn't depth in other fields, but it's just like, it's unbelievable. And I was wondering, like, that seems to me like perhaps, to my mind, the most insurmountable problem. Mm-hmm. I don't know, just bringing that up, but see if anyone had any comments.
I find the wealth of secondary scholarship, I can see how it can be viewed as something daunting, but I think it can be a benefit because it can be construed itself as data. That you've got all of these wildly different interpretations of things, and they're claiming to be based in the same thing. I mean, in the beginning of the 20th century, I think that what formed biblical scholarship was the production of commentaries. Like, to produce a commentary was on a biblical book was to sort of solidify one's position in the discipline. And in the current academic environment, the notion of a commentary that gives you the way to read a biblical text, it almost seems like an anachronism now, the production of a commentary. So what is the goal of biblical scholarship? I think it's a central and driving question that the production of all of this, what we call secondary material, is actually a wide open field for us to be rummaging around in some of the ways that we've been talking about on this panel.
Albert Schweitzer, in his big book on the history of the Jesus scholarship, writes about biblical scholarship in Germany as the greatest achievement of German academic scholarship, and points out it can't be that the issues they take up are new. They cannot be solved by traditional philological work, because there are so many of these source issues and types of criticisms that are new. And I would consider working as a biblical scholar as working on some of the texts that has been most important to form Western history and culture, and to try to understand why that is so, both in terms of the historical origin and meaning, but also in terms of transmission reception history, and how they are involved in thinking about biblical texts is partly a way of thinking about human issues. And I think that's perspective that that easily gets lost when you concentrate on commentaries. So I agree that commentaries are not helpful to bring forth these big issues.
Hi. You were talking about, or Brent was talking about, how the radical ideas of Paul really are more in line with kind of the normative ideas held by like religious studies scholarship. And what interested me about that was that it seemed to me like there's not an equivocation, but there's a similarity in behavior between what we define as religious or philosophical in some sense. And so like it reminded me of Ninian Smart or Robert D. Barrett in the way of like things that we don't traditionally consider religions having religious behaviors or religious attitudes. So I was wondering, under that idea, how do we really think of what religious studies is? Since in some ways, while we acknowledge the limitations of how we use the word religion, we're still kind of keeping to like, oh, here's the old religions, the world religions, and you have the Abrahamic religions or whatever. And so I kind of wonder if we're going to continue forward trying to relate religious studies with biblical studies, doesn't it require some sort of self-awareness of what religious studies might be?
Okay. I think, yeah, problems with definition are definitely central. That's why, for me, the most productive form of biblical studies that I see happening now forefronts that. So the work that I mentioned, Stanley Stowers, I could also mention Burton Mack. Many of the conclusions of someone like Mack I don't find compelling, but the approach that foregrounds definition, that is to explicitly say religion, I'm drawing a definition of religion that's this. I'm considering some things for the purpose of my study as religious data. This can be really helpful and illuminating in a lot of ways. I mean, the book that Tomoko mentioned that I just wrote is on the history of the concept of religion that has a focus on antiquity, on all those things that we generally call ancient religions, but which as far as we know from the textual and archaeological record, they didn't conceive of each other as religions. So the book explores how they talked about each other, how they conceptualized difference and otherness. And so I think that always keeping the question of definition central is a really helpful thing.
I would just answer that a little bit differently by saying that it depends on what we think a definition is and what it's doing. You know, and so it's useful to constantly be aware and critically aware of how we're defining things and what we're doing with them. I think of them as positional and provisional. You know, to do certain kinds of work. So to always ask ourselves if we're going to have departments of religious studies or field called religious studies, what do we want that to do? You know, rather than think of them as something fixed and set. So should biblical studies be part of it or not? The question is what do you achieve and what do you lose when you have particular kinds of groupings? And in the university, you know, I think there's a lot of discussion going on right now about what constitutes a discipline, what constitutes a field, and interdisciplinary work, mm-hmm. and cross-field work, and so on and so forth, and the realizing the limits of the ways that the particular fields have undermined the capacity to solve or talk about certain problems. Mm-hmm. You know, people talk about instead of seeing things in disciplinary modes, organizing them around a particular problem. Let's take water. You know, so we got some water issues on the planet. So, you know, who do we need to get together and how does that work and what role might religion play in such a thing? So I think it goes back to the definitional task is not the first issue on the table. The first issue on the table is what do we need doing? And then how might we, you know, organize ourselves or think about things to do that? Mm-hmm.
Well, it seems that the hour has come to the run out of time, as it seems. And I thank you very much, and it really has been, I think it's one of the really the fruitful consequence of what was a few years ago a disruption, was at least that we could have this kind of a conversation seriously. I think it was in many ways was lacking altogether. It was very strange. We were meeting year after year together, and yet there was no conversation of this sort. Which was in itself, or mutual suspicion, there was a lot of that. But nonetheless, there was no real concerted effort to engage this question itself. So I thank you very much. I hope this is only the beginning of such conversations. Thank you very much.